Wait. You have a TV?
No. I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide. You don't need a TV.
Hello, everybody. Welcome. It's TV Guidance Counselor. As always, I am Ken Reed. I am your TV Guidance Counselor, here to talk about classic television using back issues of TV Guide from my vast archives as the doorway into our collective television viewing memories of the past. Today, we have two more interviews. It's not two episodes, although, you know, you could split it into two episodes if you so chose, if you wanted to make it a two-parter. Incidentally, you know, I've been rewatching a lot of shows. This is totally unrelated to what I'm talking about and who my guests are today. But I'm watching a lot of shows on things like Netflix and Hulu and Vudu and all that kind of stuff. And it's interesting, two-part episodes, they automatically join together as a single episode. So there have been episodes where I'm like, oh, I'll watch part one tonight and then, you know, catch up tomorrow with part two. But then I realized that I've been sitting there for an hour and 15 minutes, and then I look and sure enough, they've made them into one episode, which I guess is good, but just a warning if you were unaware that they did that. They do in fact do that. Or if you are just looking to purchase single episodes of shows, the two-parters, same price as the one-parters. So for $1.99 or 99 cents or wherever you're buying your episodes, you're actually getting two episodes. So see, there you go. I already saved you money. If you want to take that money you saved and contribute to the Patreon for TV Guidance Counselor, that could be a dollar a month. It could be $10,000 a month. It could be nothing, but you can go to patreon.com/TV Guidance Counselor if you'd like to do that, because I'm all about saving you money, but you don't have to do that. Anyway, if you are unfamiliar with the show, welcome. I hope that you enjoy this episode. This one is slightly unusual in that the episode, my interviews are from Denver Comic Con. They are a little more straightforward with some audience Q&A. They are not the flipping through the TV guide format. However, we do discuss TV quite a bit, and they are excellent guests. So I would not want to deny the world hearing these episodes. So first up, we have David Harbour, who you probably know as Hopper from Stranger Things, but is in a ton of stuff. Couldn't be a nicer guy. Maybe the greatest human being I've ever met in my life. And then after that, we have Ron Perlman, an amazing human being as well. Both have played Hellboy, so it's sort of a Hellboy double feature here. And both are, as I said, are from Denver Comic Con back in June. I still am amazed that they had me and let me talk to these people. So first up, please sit back, relax, and enjoy the first chat I had from Denver Comic Con with Hellboy number 2, David Harbour.
TV is my friend, and it has been always there for me in time of need.
So I'm very excited to talk to you. I'm a huge fan of all the stuff that you've done. Obviously, I'm sure people will ask questions about Stranger Things and Hellboy and all that stuff coming up. But the first thing I remember seeing you on was Pan Am, which I think might have been your first recurring.
Yes, me and Margot Robbie, who you may know.
And that show, I think, was sort of...
I played a British super spy.
Yes, a double agent. You were a KGB agent, too.
I know, at the end I was, because they didn't know what to do at the end of the show. So they like made me a villain. It was awful.
Like, do you just show up for work and they're like, oh, you're the villain now?
Yeah, basically. It was terrible. But the show was kind of okay. Like, some first six episodes were kind of good.
Yeah, and it was cool. It was obviously in the wake of Mad Men. They were like, we'll do a 60s piece on a plane.
Exactly. Which a lot was cool. Of smoking that yes. We couldn't do because we were on NBC. So you had to keep the cigarette like this far away from your face. Just pretend to smoke it.
Just out of frame.
Which we don't have to do on Stranger Things, which is excellent.
Yes. And then I saw you on a reoccurring role on The Newsroom, I think was the next thing, which is Aaron Sorkin.
Yeah. There were things in between that were terrible. But yes.
Okay, But you were a news anchor, and I think you were on like a bunch of episodes, right?
In The Newsroom?
Yeah.
I was the kind of dumber anchor, Elliot Hirsch.
Yes.
kind of dumber than Jeff Daniels, a little more handsome, much more into Twitter.
That's how I would describe you to people.
Just in general, David Harbour.
Yeah. But a lot of actors that I know, when they do that, those Aaron Sorkin shows, it's such a that Aaron Sorkin like dialogue, and it's so stylized, and they're like so aware that they're in an Aaron Sorkin show.
Yeah.
And I imagine that was sort of a weird change for you, or was it kind of like?
Yeah, it's not my thing.
Yeah.
It's not my thing.
Yeah.
Like walking down hallways, talking very excitedly. As you can tell in most of my performances, I like to be very slow and, you know.
You're chilled out.
Angry. And yeah. That just doesn't fit the Sorkin universe. You're supposed to be really smart and kind of positive and bright and think about changing the world. And I like characters that are kind of selfish and dark and occasionally are thrown into situations where they just have to be heroic.
Yeah, to save themselves.
Because it's easier than the alternative.
This will save me some time. I guess I'll do it.
Yeah. Exactly.
It's like seethingly angry. Exactly. So I don't know how much you can talk about Hellboy. Is there... I'm sure there are probably things you can't discuss.
Yeah, Hellboy. Where's Ron Perlman? I know he's in the building.
Did you talk to him about it? Have you talked to him?
Yeah, we had dinner. Yeah. Yeah, he's a great guy. I can. There is a character called Hellboy that I will be playing. I could say that.
Is that the first role you've had where you're under prosthetics, like you're really made up and have had to do acting through this like 6 inches of plastic?
Yeah. There's not a lot of prosthetics that go into like Jim Hopper and Pan Am and stuff.
It was
like 2.5 hours it's a full silicone mask. I'm sorry to disappoint everyone. Everyone tells me to lie about this, and I really should lie about it, but that body is not my body. So there's like all these articles about how in shape and buffed out I got for Hellboy, and it's all lies. It's the one time when I understand Donald Trump's frustration with fake news. But like for me, fake news is great.
Yeah.
Like it makes me look like super awesome. Like I actually did work out a lot. I got very strong for it. But most of the stuff you see on my body is prosthetics. So like that was a whole thing. The face was a whole thing. The horns, the hair. There were eye pieces that were yellow contacts. Mm-hmm. The mouth, the lower teeth was a whole piece. But the entire thing is practical. So the cool thing that you'll see on it is like when you see that picture of me or other, hopefully a trailer will come out soon and you'll see other pictures of me, it's all practical. So that stuff is entirely real. It's physical. It has density. It has weight. None of it is CGI. So like that Thanos thing that you see in the Marvel movie, that's not happening in our movie. All the monsters in our movie are practical monsters, like made by this guy, Joel Harlow. What's up? Give it up for practical things.
Monsters and even, you can punch.
And even, even the stunts in it are practical stunts. So there's not this seat, there's like people getting hurt right in front of you, which is like, I love that.
That's what we want to see.
No, it is. It's like a soccer game. Like there are moments, we shot in Bulgaria and there's these big Bulgarian stunt guys who are just violent and angry and vicious, and they just punched me right in the face between takes and
Into character.
Yeah, it was great. No, they're it's all practical. So in that way, it's a very different movie than a lot of the stuff you're seeing now. There's no like, you know, hyper real. There's a little bit of hyper real stuff, but in general, it's a lot of practical fighting. It's a lot of practical moving around with these big old monsters, and it's like exciting. When we were working on it, it was just really an exciting thing. It was like a throwback in a certain way.
Yeah.
And also it was like a big like kung fu movie. It was like, you know, there's like a lot of big practical fights with monsters. You don't see that stuff anymore.
I mean, I imagine it makes it easier for you to act, although you're acting through all that stuff, but you don't have to imagine this stuff. And also to get a sense of what the movie's going to be like or the end product's going to be like. Because when you're acting opposite a green screen, you're like, I hope this looks good when it's done.
Yeah, and no I mean, idea. Like CGI, like it's great, like it works in certain scenarios, and I like it. But in general, I find that it doesn't have density. Like there's something about physics. Like when you hit something and it falls to the ground, and you're like, ouch. That like CGI doesn't have that same sort of density
sort of
to it. Like, yeah, and sort of like. I don't know, like I'm never really worried about Spider-Man like falling from a building, like,
yeah.
Cause, and the way they paint it, like the way they arrange their shots is like it's framed up for the computer to come in. Whereas this, it's like actually the camera catching the action, and that's a very different feel of a movie. Like they did in Mad Max Fury Road.
Yes.
Like that's a movie where all those guys are doing practical stunts. So you feel when they're driving these cars and those dudes are like hanging off the side,
insane. You're
like, that guy's yeah. gonna kill himself. And yeah. it makes me like watch the movie.
Yeah.
Whereas like some of the time with CGI, I'm just like, nah, he'll be fine.
Yeah,
like,
they'll just reboot.
He'll break his computerized nose, but we'll all, yeah. it'll look pretty.
His computer crashed.
Yeah, place. Yeah.
That guy got set on fire.
Just reboot him.
Yes, just reboot. Turn him on and off again. So let's take some questions from the audience. What do we got here? We have one over here. Where are we?
Yeah. What's up, Denver? Who's got questions?
Yeah.
Anything you
we got
like.
One.
Anything you like.
We got one. What do we
right
got?
Over here on way, 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 way in the corner. More. To your right. To your right.
To my
there
right.
You
oh,
go.
There we are.
Hey.
Yeah.
Hey.
I can't see anything.
Hi.
Hey.
Are you going to be in any more Tide commercials?
That's the first one.
I hate to break it to you guys, but this isn't a Comic-Con panel. It's a Tide ad.
Yeah. They're doing these viral stunts.
He's giving you the eye, man.
Yeah. Was the Tide ad, was the stain practical or was it a CG stain?
You know what? To be honest, it was a CGI stain.
Oh, man.
I didn't have a stain, but we did these promos with the football guy.
Joe Montana.
No,
oh,
come on.
Gronk.
No, the guy who did it last year did the Tide ad with the stain. Terry Bradshaw. Oh, that's embarrassing. Terry Bradshaw did a commercial, and we did some promos with me and him that we put out online, and he stains his shirt in it, and it was a CGI stain. So I'm as embarrassed as anyone.
This is a bombshell that Bradshaw doesn't do his own stains.
He doesn't do his own stains. You heard it here first in Denver.
Another question?
Thank you for your question.
Where are we? Yes, you.
Oh, hi, I have a very serious question.
Go ahead.
Denny's, Waffle House, or IHOB?
Oh my God. has anybody seen any of the Wendy's Twitter about that?
Yeah.
Whoever's doing the Twitter account for Wendy's is killing it. Because they were like, we're not too afraid. Someone was like, what do you think about that? Wendy's IHOP is like going to be about burgers. And they were like, yeah, people who can't even handle pancakes, like we're not that scared.
Did they just hire like a high school sophomore girl?
Yeah.
Who's just like,
yeah,
really?
Basically just be really like trolly. Yeah. Has anyone ever ordered a burger at IHOP?
Not on purpose.
Yeah, right? What are you guys? Way to read a room, guys.
And the burger market, it's not like it's oversaturated right now or anything either. Like, that's what the world needs is more burgers.
So you asked, I'll go Waffle House, because we shoot in Atlanta. We shoot in Atlanta, and there have been two things in Atlanta that I've been introduced to by a friend of mine. I say he's a friend of mine. He introduced me first to something called Bojangles. You guys have that out here?
What
oh
is
my
it?
God, a cheddar bow is like, it's like a heart attack waiting to happen, but it's so delicious. And then Waffle House, go get a tuna melt at Waffle House, or a burger, but I like myself a Waffle House tuna melt. So yeah, IHOP can go, you know, suck it.
And Waffle House, their jukebox has all songs about waffles on it.
I've never played the jukebox. Look at the jukebox.
They have songs written for Waffle House, recorded about waffles on the entire jukebox in every Waffle House.
This is going to be my new playlist when I go work out. The waffle playlist.
That's how he got jacked for Hellboy. He just worked out to the Waffle House playlist.
It was just constant waffle workouts.
Where else? Next question. We're over here. Yes.
Okay, so if you were to run into Ron Perlman here at Comic-Con, who do you think would win in a fight, you or Ron Perlman?
We're talking physical or?
Wow.
Yeah,
intellectual, he'd destroy me. That dude is smart. And he's also a powerful guy. We had dinner in L.A. like right before I started shooting, actually. Me, him, and Patton Oswalt got together. Yeah. Patton was trying to broker,
Yeah, because he could break up you guys.
It was a peace talk. But Ron is a strong individual, but I fight dirty. So I'd put my money on me in the end.
We got another one?
Okay, so hi, I'm Sam.
Hi, Sam.
I was nervous, so I wrote it down. So awesome. You got to meet the penguins in Antarctica recently, and what was it like to actually go on this huge trip with Greenpeace?
That's a great question. Thank you for asking me that. It was incredible. Like, here's the thing. Like, it's funny. I do live in a world where I love a lot of jokes and, a lot of fun, and I love this sci-fi and all the genre stuff, and I love the passion that all the fans have for it. But I do feel like we all have to galvanize to save the Earth because we're in a lot of trouble. So if we can all split the passion that we have for all this genre stuff and just take a half hour out of your day to think about how we can save this environment together, because I learned from Greenpeace that we're in like deep shit, basically. My girlfriend was she's an ambassador for Antarctica for Greenpeace. And so I kind of hitched a ride based on all your Twitter retweets, which I really appreciate. I hitched a ride down to Antarctica on this boat through the Drake Passage, by the way, which is 3 days in the most treacherous open water in the world on a really small boat with 20-foot swells. And I started throwing up 3 hours in. And then 72 hours later, we got through the passage. So I almost died. I became like Gollum in my stateroom, in my little room. My girlfriend was super tough, and she would come in and be like, "How are you doing?" And I'd be like, "Get away from me! I'm so ugly!" And then we got down to Antarctica, and it truly is a stunningly beautiful place. I have to say, there are ways to get there. And they are very conscious, even the cruise ships, about leaving very little footprint. But it's like these placid lakes. I've never wanted to swim in an ocean more. It's so beautiful. If you go in, you freeze to death in minutes. But
what a way to go, though.
Yeah, but what a way to go. But the wildlife down there, the whales, the penguins, and just the fact that we're already starting to exploit this place by krill fishing, these like Eastern European companies are sending these fish down there with these big old hoses, and they're just sucking krill, which everything feeds down there, the whales and stuff. And they're just making like krill pills. Like, it's not even they're making like Ferraris out of them.
Because they're basically like sea monkeys. They're little teeny tiny specks.
Yeah, but like whales and penguins, and also they are a carbon sink for global warming. They're amazing things, and they're just destroying the environment. So it was a beautiful trip, and it really opened my eyes to the fact that like the clock is ticking and we need to cut down our footprint as much as we can. We need to save the Earth so that we can have, Comic-Cons for the rest of our lives. Get rid of plastic straws, please. You don't need them. You don't need them. Just drink out of a cup. So let's get rid of plastic straws. Let's just try to get rid of as much plastic as we can, because when we were there, we found plastic in Antarctica, and that was very depressing. But thank you very much for the question. Beautiful. Thank you.
We all love post-apocalyptic movies, but let's keep them as movies.
Exactly. Yeah. Let Hellboy bring about the end of the world, not like Eastern European krill fishing shit.
Yes, yeah. Yes.
Hey, I really loved you in Hellboy, which has kind of like a fantasy aspect to it.
And then in Stranger Things, we got a little bit kind of more of a sci-fi. Wondering which way you're enjoying playing more, fantasy or sci-fi?
We'll see. The Hellboy thing, which comes out in January, I was not very good in the first two movies because it was Ron Perlman who was in them. But
he was excellent.
I did
you.
A great Ron Perlman impression. But Hellboy is, you know, it's more. It's a superhero movie, but it's also kind of a horror movie, and it's also a monster movie. Like so, in that way, it owes a lot to these old monster movies like Frankenstein. It also owes a lot to the horror genre, a movie like It or something. There's a lot of stuff in our Hellboy universe, which is, you know, it's a dark tale. It involves this blood queen who is like not a very pleasant lady.
I wouldn't have thought that by her name.
Enjoys blood. So there's a lot of blood in it. But I really did like, I like that. And then, you know, Stranger Things is more of kind of a sci-fi genre thing. But in terms of acting, like whenever I'm acting in anything, it's really about, it's less about the genre, it's less about the actual thing, and it's more about the character and sort of being true. And I like to go very deep into my characters, and I like them to be very emotionally resonant and very psychologically resonant. So, you know, Jim Hopper, like I really want you to be moved by his struggle to deal with the loss of his daughter, his struggle to be a good man even though he isn't, his darkness. And in terms of Hellboy, I did a really deep dive into Hellboy, what it means to be an orphan, to be sort of brought into this world unexpectedly, to speak a different language than you do, to be have a destiny that seems bigger than you and to try to fight against it. And also to try to be a good paranormal detective, like in this world where there's a lot of threats. But there's a lot of elements to Hellboy that I really wanted to ground psychologically. And so I did a lot of work on that. And then you just get to have the sheer fun. You kind of let it go. And then you have the sheer fun of like a big monster movie. But with all my characters, it really is about, I mean, I really believe in like a deep dive about acting, whatever genre they're in. It's really just about being true to the spirit and the psychology of an individual, how they live and where you think they'll be, you know, at any given point in their life.
Sort of the more realistic and grounded the character is, the easier it is to for the audience to buy craziness around it, sort of.
Yeah, like, yeah, that's true. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I just want people to feel things. It's my major thing is like I want you to go to things I'm in, and I want you to feel a catharsis, like see yourself in this person, in their struggle, in maybe the fact that they're an outcast, and so I want to bring that like to life. I mean, Hellboy himself has a lot of those ideas, like he's hated by humanity to a certain degree, and so because he's the bringer of the apocalypse,
he's gonna kill us all.
Yeah, exactly. So you know,
we're judgmental,
but so I want you to feel. I mean, I want you to feel deeply about that, and I feel like if you condescend to the character, then you're not going to get people that, you know, you really need to go in deep and be like, what are these things in me and how can I resonate in my flesh and in my blood and in my everything, this pain. And so, you know, the deeper you go, I think the more resonant it is for an audience.
Do you find that easier with genre stuff because of the sort of inherent allegory that exists in those?
I mean, I approach genre stuff like I actually, to be honest, I come from a Shakespeare background. So a lot of the great genre stuff comes from Shakespearean actors. I mean, you look at Ian McKellen's Gandalf, or you look at Patrick Stewart's Star Trek The Next Generation. Yeah. Like, these are guys who are legendary British Shakespearean actors. And they deal with the genre stuff so well, because in Shakespeare, you're dealing with, like Hamlet deals with the ghost of his father. Like it's not a kitchen sink drama.
He deals witches. With witches.
There's witches. Yeah. So there are these big hyper real things that we ground in Shakespeare. That I think when you know Shakespearean actors come to, and I found a lot of that in Hellboy too. It's like there were these big things about responsibility and about destiny that I had dealt with in characters that I played in Shakespeare.
Well, like Midsummer's Night's Dream isn't that different from Hellboy in a lot of ways, where you have like those sort of fantastical characters.
A little lighter, but
I mean, I guess a little bit. It depends on what production you see. But I mean, you know, that sort of fantasy sort of those characters
totally.
In the different worlds.
No, totally. And like, you know, certainly destiny, like characters, like you look at a character like Edmund in King Lear, and like he's someone who is sort of the antithesis of Hellboy, like his destiny has been defined as something lesser than his will. And so he's using his will to battle against his destiny. And in a sense, Hellboy's doing the exact same thing. Hellboy's just trying to make the world a better place, where Edmund's trying to make the world a better place for him.
Is there a Shakespearean play that you haven't been in that you'd still like to do?
Yeah, there's one role that I'm dying to do. It's a play called Coriolanus. Okay. Yeah, if people know this play, it's a rather obscure Shakespeare play. It rarely gets done, but it's about this guy who's like this great general in Rome, and he's like the greatest general they have, but he doesn't really believe in democracy. He believes that the smartest, bravest, strongest people should rule, and everyone else should be grateful. And so he's kind of a fascist.
Okay, yeah.
And it's a problem.
That is a problem.
When you're like in a democracy.
Yeah.
So, and he's also got this mother that's like hyper obsessed with him, and she loves when he's covered in blood. When he comes home from battle, his wife's really scared, and his mother's like, "Oh, I love when he's covered in blood." It's a weird play.
Yeah, that sounds
strange. It's a very beautiful play, though. I'd highly recommend you read it. But I've always wanted to play Coriolanus.
Someday. All right, more questions. Where are we?
Right here, middle.
Middle.
Hi. So hey. Newsroom actually happens to be one of my favorite shows, and I loved your character.
Oh, wow, thanks.
And I just wanted to know what it was like reliving some of the major moments that they covered through new eyes.
Oh, yeah, because they cover, like, the Boston Marathon bombing, and they cover a lot of new
Events. Yeah, it was always really interesting, and it was really interesting, like, their take on it. Like, I remember, too, some things would happen, and then we would wait for the next season to come out. Like, I remember there was a thing where Anderson Cooper got beat up in the Arab Spring, like, when he was in Egypt, I think. And he got just beat up by a mob. And then they came back and did a story on it on CNN. And I remember thinking, like, oh, that's great. Like, we're going to do something like that. And then the next season, Elliot Hirsch goes and gets beat up. And then comes back, and they talk about doing a story on it. And they're like, that would have no integrity. Like, basically, like, we trashed CNN a little bit. And it was, but it was great. Things like that that I would see in the news and then sort of wait for the next season to come around. It was a sort of fun thing.
Thank you. Question over here on the left.
Hi, I was just wondering if you had any great moments to recall shooting Stranger Things while you were the great Sheriff Harper.
Thanks. I have a lot of fun on that set. I mean, it's very intense work, but it's also just very fun. Like, I remember season one, I think it's episode 5 or something, after I get in the lab, they like stick me in the neck, and then I wake up on my couch and I think my apartment is bugged. My apartment.
You're tearing everything apart.
My $2 trailer. There's a little story about that. The art department, by the way, bought that for $1. My trailer. But I tear it apart looking for a bug. And I remember we were going to shoot it in all these different ways. They had all these like breakaway glasses, and they were like, you can break this, but you can't break that. And you can like touch this, but you can't touch that. And I was like, can we just get Bob, who's our camera guy, who's incredible, shot The Dark Knight, shot all of Tarantino's films. He's an amazing camera op. These are the unsung heroes of our show. There's these departments that are incredible. But Bob, who shot these movies, I was like, Bob, can you just put a camera on and just follow me around, and I'm just going to tear shit up? And he was like, yeah, let's do that. And so that take is one take where I just go around the apartment like, you know, I'm like drooling and sweating, and I'm just cutting couches and like throwing things left and right, and none of that stuff. Everyone was like terrified that we were gonna have bad focus and not be able to use it. But that was probably my most fun day on set, was just destroying my $1 trailer.
That'd be a good business. People just pay to destroy a trailer to get their frustrations out.
Yeah, I'd do it.
Yeah. Where are we? Over here, yes.
Hi, I'm Emily. And I was wondering, what was your favorite scene to film in Stranger Things, and who was your favorite kid to film with?
Okay. My favorite kid to film with. It's so hard to choose between your children.
Who's the worst one?
Right? It really does. It is like having six children or whatever, however many they are. They keep multiplying. But there's like, it really is. It's like one day, one week, one of them will be my favorite. The next week, another one will be my favorite. So clearly, like, Millie and I have a special relationship where it's like, we really are like father and daughter. Like, I know her very well, and like, I love her, and I think she's really great. And she annoys me, and I get mad at her, and like any dad and their kid, it's like, you know, I'm very invested. So of course the scenes with Millie are wonderful to film and exciting, because I think she's a very exciting actress. But this last season, like working with Finn, who I didn't get a chance to do a lot with, like, it was really fun. That kid is really kind of amazing. I'm kind of jealous of how cool he is at, like, this delicate stage. Like, who's cool at 14? Like, that kid is actually cool. But I really like working with Finn. He's very smart, and he's a very instinctual actor, and he brings a lot of surprises. So, like, that one scene we had where we were beating, he beats me up, and, like, he brought a lot of surprises to that scene. He surprised me a lot. It was great. And then this season, spoiler alert, I have a scene with Finn Wolfhard. There you go, Netflix. They're going to call me tomorrow. Wow,
this is, TMZ is making much.
I do have a scene with him this season, which we shot, which was, again, like, very surprising. Like, I thought he was just, he's just a really wonderful little actor, so... I had a good time with him.
Cool. We probably have time for two, maybe three more questions. So we're right in the middle.
What's up?
That's one. We got two more left.
So for season three of Stranger Things, will Netflix have to CGI your mustache too?
Yeah, they're going to CGI a cornfield. And
on your
they're
face?
CGI out my mustache. No, did you notice that in that DC movie? They CGI'd not only his mustache out, but they CGI'd the cornfield around him, too.
You can't find a cornfield to shoot it.
Yeah, right? It's impossible. look, here's the spoiler, is that Hopper has a mustache in season three. Look, everybody goes through hard times. You know what I mean? Everybody goes through things. And I'm not going to make Hopper... You know, he's got his own issues that he's working out. So, yeah, I haven't shot in about a week, so it's a little bit grown in. But Hopper season three is a mustache man. He's decided that that's the way to go in 1985. And he's not alone of men his age in 1985 thinking that a mustache is a good idea.
Magnum was huge.
We will see if you agree with it. But, yeah, we'll see. I'll probably shave it in episode 8. We'll see.
It'll be integral to the plot for you to shave this in episode 8.
Yeah.
Cool. Two more. Where are we? Over in the back. Okay. Yes.
Hi. I loved you in Stranger Things.
Thanks.
And I just wanted to know what it's like meeting fans in public. Like, how does that feel?
It's really great. I mean, you know, I think that the wonderful thing about it is... I think people have different things when they have fans. Like, there are people that are just celebrities that have fans, like, who just do, like, celebrity things, or, like, you know them or something. And then there's people like me who I feel like you love the character of Hopper, and that's the reason why you're going to come up to me, mainly. Although there's other work I've done, too, that people like. But in general, it's because I feel like you just love the show, and you just love the character. And that's why you want to say hi to me or take a selfie with me or whatever. And I feel like that's something that's beautiful and special, because, like, that's all I've ever wanted to do as an actor, is to move people or to make them feel something or to make them happy or have them cry and then be happy later or something. So that, like, the fact that I'm doing that on a large level and people are fans of it is a beautiful thing. But it's always really about that for me, as opposed to just like being a celebrity. Like, I always sort of want you to approach me, maybe because you've been moved by something I do or because it's specific in that way. And I feel that from the fans. And that just means that I'm sort of doing my job. And that's all I've ever wanted to do my whole life. So thank you guys, really.
Yeah, so you feel like you've earned it. You've earned the, yeah, it's a validation of the work that
you
do.
I don't know if you ever really earn it. I mean, it's so nice. It's like, yeah. I don't know if I ever feel like, yeah, I've earned it. Like, I feel, yeah. It's more, I feel like grateful that it's come across. Yeah. Like, but it is in gratitude to your careful watching and to your investment in the show. And that is a beautiful thing.
Excellent. So probably one more. Yes.
Hi, I'm a big fan of your work, but I also really love your Twitter feed.
Thanks.
And you have a great relationship with your fans, going back to that last question. I'm wondering, you mentioned Greenpeace. What was the craziest request that you fulfilled by someone saying, will you come to my prom? I'd love to know what was the craziest.
You did go to a prom.
I didn't go to a prom. I spaced them out a little bit. The one that I did was a girl asked me to take her high school senior photos with her.
Oh, yes, yes.
And I said I would do it if she got 25,000 retweets, only if I got to wear the school sweatshirt and hold a trombone.
It's a hard bargain.
And she agreed to that. She got 25,000 retweets in like 3 minutes or something. Because everyone was like, we would like to humiliate David Harbour in this way. Thank you very much. And we did it. Like, we actually set up a studio at Netflix, and you could see the pictures. They're on my Instagram and in her senior yearbook, if you happen to see that. But it was hilarious and really fun. Like, we got a really cool photographer. We did it totally legit, like a high school. And then the other one that I agreed to was there's a couple that asked me to officiate their wedding in September. I said that I would do that if I got to read a letter about love that of my choosing, and also if I got to eat the first piece of cake. Not, they get to smear it on each other's faces, and I'm not going to ruin that, but I will demand the first piece after that.
Is the flavor choice up to them, though, or do you have some input in what kind of cake?
No, they get to choose everything. So, but we will do this in September. I've reached out to them. And as long as we can make it, like, not about me. It is a day of, like, marriage between two people and love between two people, so I don't want to ruin it. But they have agreed, and I'm like, so I'm getting ordained as a minister. It's not a very difficult thing to do online. It's not like I'm reading the Bible like crazy.
Been studying hard.
No, but I'm getting ordained, and I will officiate their wedding in September. That was a really cool one. And then there was the Greenpeace one, which was sort of my ask. And then, like, the funny thing is, when the show comes out, I find that people on Twitter say such ridiculous, funny things to me, and then it kind of peters out. But I was in Bulgaria in October when the show dropped, shooting Hellboy, and I would shoot Hellboy all day, and then I would come home to my Bulgarian hotel room and just be miserable because I was in Bulgaria and I didn't speak any of the language or know anyone. So I would just sit on my Bulgarian couch and I would just look at Twitter, and people would say all these hilarious things. And so I would just, like, retweet a bunch of them and, like, talk about them. But that was the one that I did that request. I did the wedding one. I just kind of don't want to get annoying with them. I sort of want it to be something, and the ones that I gravitate towards are the ones where it's kind of annoying for me to do, and it'll take like a week of like me being annoyed and like having to travel to places and like having to be grumpy for a little bit. Like, I don't want it to be so easy that I could just do it, that I'll agree to this.
You
want to
suffer a little.
Yeah, I wanted to suffer. I want you guys to know that it sucks for me to have to go to Illinois and get ordained and the whole thing. But I also don't want to wear out my welcome with them, so I'm kind of a little bit like back and forth on the Twitter thing. But I've done a couple. I do really enjoy it, and we'll see. If you guys do tweet me like a really special one, I may jump on it. But you know, we'll see.
What a challenge to end on.
What a challenge. There you go. Now it's in your hands.
Thank you guys so much. Please thank David Harbour, everybody.
There you go. David Harbour, as I said, probably the greatest human being to ever walk the face of the earth. But, you know, I'm slightly biased. He's a great, great guy. Next up, we have Ron Perlman. And Just a warning, this does contain language. Ron had a long weekend, and as had I. This was, I think, the last panel we did on the Sunday, maybe the last panel of the whole entire convention. What a fascinating guy, amazing story, such a great actor, been in so many great things that I've enjoyed over the years. So please sit back, relax, and enjoy this chat I had with Mr. Ron Perlman.
Mr. Ron Perlman, everybody, please welcome him.
Awesome.
Thank you. Very nice to see you. Oh, the classic Perlman curtsy. It's great to see you. You're one of the...
There's some empty seats up there.
There are, yeah.
Where's the rest of you?
We're going to CG that in. We got some sitters. Look at the Emmys.
This is like the Trump inauguration over here.
This is way bigger than that. There's almost 1,000 people here.
Not quite as empty as his policies, though.
No. You and I share a hatred for that man.
I mean, I would say fuck Trump, but I don't want to steal Bobby De Niro's line.
No. Yeah. Inhabiting a new role. So you're one of those actors that you've done so many roles under heavy makeup, but have this amazing ability. We always know it's you. Like, you have a unique ability to...
Yeah, because that's my name in the credits.
It's your name. That's the thing.
People know because they say, oh, that's Ron Perlman.
But they never think of you as like a creature actor. You know what I mean? You're always Ron Perlman. You're an actor. But when I look back at... so many of the roles. You're from the first thing I think I saw you in, which was Quest for Fire, right? Was it Quest for Fire? To Beauty and the Beast, the Hellboy, that you were under all this makeup. And is that, I think it takes a special kind of actor to be able to act like that. Is that something you immediately had a skill with, or did you have to learn it?
It was weird because, I mean, it's not like The only part of my career where I've kind of had an ability to say yes or no or make a choice is the last few years. But the first 25, 30 years of my career, I there was no design on my part. You know, these things, every single thing that happened was purely coincidental and purely some sort of random act of the universe. So... The audition for Quest for Fire, which was, I had never done a movie before, it was as if you were going to audition for the geek in Ringling Brothers, Barnum and Bailey Circus.
Bite the head off this chicken.
They had motherfuckers in here, man. One guy had one arm coming out of his ass and another one coming out of his neck. And there was a guy who was about 7'14". And his head was this big. I mean, you know, and I'm going, oh shit, this is the group I fall into, you know, this is like, this is my wheelhouse, man. So you didn't really have to, you know, be very impressive to get like a lead role in that movie. You just had to kind of be breathing and, you know, not be terminal.
He has a head.
What happened was, you know, one thing leads to another. You do a role where there's two kinds of acting. There's representational acting where you're using yourself to depict the behavior of a character you're supposed to be playing. And then there's that kind of acting where you're transforming yourself into an abstract being that may or may not have ever existed, but that is a purely superficial, a supercilious,
it's not based in reality. You have to ground something that's sort of
what's the genre? You know,
supernatural.
Supernatural character. That's it. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
The medication is going to kick in any time now.
Yeah.
But
I saw his nurse backstage.
But so I do one role where I'm like, you know, covered in makeup and a mask, and then all of a sudden I'm on the short list for other roles where I'm covered. So that leads to Name of the Rose, and then that leads to Beauty and the Beast, and then that leads to, what else was there?
Island of Dr. Moreau.
The Island of Dr. Moreau, and then ultimately Hellboy.
But to be able to put up with that, because some actors can't deal with it.
Well, there's the other part of it, which is that in order to get made up for those roles, you have to be willing to sit there for 4 hours usually and do nothing while somebody else is applying the stuff onto you. What people don't know about me is that what I love to do more than anything else is sit in one place and do nothing. So I'm your motherfucker when it comes to, you know, like, you want me to sit around and do nothing? Call me. I'll give you all my number if you could pay me for that shit.
We need an actor who's great at waiting for, you know, buses.
There's a lot of actors that get very like antsy in the chair and, you know, like restless and want to go out and, you know, get on the phone. Nah, man.
I get some peace. I get some me time. So Beauty and the Beast was enormous. It was a huge show. It was very popular, and you got to be on, I think it was a top 10 show, without probably being, it seemed to go on for 3 seasons, though, and it was, everyone talked about it.
If you count from the bottom.
Yeah, I mean top 10 of the bottom.
If you count from the lowest rated show, it was in the top 10.
Compared to shows now, I'm saying.
Yeah.
But I mean, was it 3 seasons? It went on a while.
2.5 seasons.
Yeah, I mean, a huge show on a major network, and because you're under makeup the whole time, it's not like people probably weren't recognizing you like they would for Linda Hamilton, or I mean, people probably know from Terminator 2, but that has to be kind of freeing. You get to be a major star of a major sitcom, not sitcom, but a major network show without having to deal with a lot of the life invasive stuff that comes with it.
I'll give you a little example. Generally, I had to get, in order to be ready to work at 8 o'clock in the morning, I usually had to get there at 4 a.m., me and my makeup artist, to get ready. So by the time I got on the set, I was fully Vincent, fully, you know, the Beast. And one day in the second season, I got a late call. I got a call where I didn't have to be ready until noon, so they called me in at around 8 o'clock in the morning, and they had already started filming. So I stopped off at the food, you know, station, the craft service table, you know, and I'm buttering a bagel, and there's two crew members who I have now been working with for a year and a half, talking shit about me. Had no idea it was me. They had never seen me. They'd only seen, you know, this, you know, with the hair on his nose, that guy. He's such an asshole. Jesus Christ. Anyway.
I think we got our answer.
I didn't interrupt him or nothing. I just wanted to hear the rest of this shit. It was.
You didn't join in, be like, you know that guy.
And I joined in. I said, Jesus, what an asshole that guy. They thought they recognized the voice, and they went.
And you're in a movie that I loved growing up and watched all the time, and I don't know if you get this one often, but Ice Pirates, I'm a huge fan of. I love that movie. Robert Urich is great in that movie.
Yeah, there's a really small group, like a cult of people who want to talk about Ice
it's
Pirates.
It's me and four guys.
I'm not in that cult,
no,
personally.
No. I mean, it seemed like a movie that was fun to make when you watch it, but it may very well not have been.
You know, you have your high points as an actor, and you have your low points.
Yeah.
I'm not going to identify which one that.
Yes. We'll move on. I'm also a great fan of Drive, which is slightly different from Ice Pirates.
Even I like that one.
Yeah. But you got the sort of comedic scenes in the movie were a lot of your stuff, and you got to act opposite one of my favorite comics in the world, Mr. Albert Brooks, who was terrifying in that movie. Was the tone hard to strike in that? Did you have...
No, it was a wonderful collaboration, because when we all first got assembled, the script was only about 30% written. You know, it had gone through a lot of iterations, but by the time it arrived into the hands of Nick Reffin and Ryan Gosling, their vision for it was very, very unique. So we all participated in kind of helping to create what the movie ultimately ended up being. And everybody was working to their strengths, you know, and everybody was being asked to give their version of who are you in this world? Who do you want to be in this world? And so it was one of those rare things where we all had a kind of an input. So by the time we were shooting the film, there was a great deal of ownership of what each of us were playing.
Yeah, I mean, it shows on screen. It's everyone seems so on board with that movie. And then was Cronos, Cronos was the first time you worked with Guillermo, right?
Cronos was the first time Guillermo worked with Guillermo.
Yes, that's true.
I mean, Guillermo had been working with Guillermo, but nobody knew about it. But you know, because he was doing a lot of, you know, genre TV in Mexico, but very local. And Cronos was the first feature film he ever made. And luckily, that film traveled to beyond the shores of Mexico to the rest of the world, and that's where the legend of Guillermo del Toro began to be formed.
It's such an unusual movie, especially at the time that it came out, when stuff we were getting in the horror genre was, you know, Dr. Giggles. You know, we weren't getting a thoughtful movie that's an allegory for aging and, you know, has all the things that we love about classic horror. How, when that script came across you, were you like, this is unusual? Did you immediately know that it was something different?
I not only immediately knew that it was something different, but I had the sense that this was a movie that would never, ever get greenlit in the United States because it didn't resemble anything you'd ever seen before. And, you know, the U.S. is famous for, especially the last 30 years, just repeating itself and, you know, not being very adventurous, doing things that they know are going to work, things you've seen 100 times before. This movie, on paper, was ultimately a vampire movie, but it was ultimately so much more. And the way it arrives at being a vampire movie covered vast amounts of allegorical, metaphorical, kind of human condition characteristics, which was actually Guillermo serving notice that he was going to use genre, but not just for genre's sake, but as a springboard towards juxtaposing it against some of the more radical impulses in the human condition. You know, Pan's Labyrinth is this magical world juxtaposed against this horrific fascism of Spain in the 30s, you know, and that's what Guillermo does, and that's why he's one of our more important artists, because his movies aren't just one thing. They're always, you know, 15 different things operating at the same time, incredibly elegantly done, beautifully done. Cinema at its most sophisticated.
I mean, it harkens back to, it makes, to me, it's evident that he grew up on things like The Twilight Zone and things like Night Gallery, where I always say those shows made us better people. And kind of to your point where we started here, those allegories of shows when we were growing up watching kids and even the movies, we learned how to be a better human whether we knew it or not. And you could watch The Devil's Backbone for the super, it's a beautiful hunting movie, and not see the allegory of war and life and death and that sort of thing. But that's still gonna seep in a little bit whether you want it to or not. And it's great that that's not lost. We're still getting those kind of movies, but to your point, they're few and far between still. And we, you know, get a remake of something from last year.
And, you know, the system, I had a talk with Guillermo about a month ago. We were at a film festival together. He was being given a Lifetime Achievement Award. Of course, I was giving it to him. I'm never...
You'll get one.
You know, they told me he was giving me one. That's how they fucking got me the fucking screen.
The classic ruse.
I should have known better. Right? But anyway, I'm giving him this piece of shit Lifetime Achievement Award, you know. I mean, literally, like, come on, what has he done lately? You know, he hasn't won an Academy Award in about a month and a half, so.
He's lazy.
Lazy. Anyway, but I we had this conversation, you know, he assumes, because he's Guillermo del Toro, that, you know, it's easy to, I mean, I'm here to tell you the system is not set up for the emergence of a Guillermo del Toro. In order for that to take place, you have to be ruthless. You have to be ready to say no, go fuck yourself to the system. You have to really, really, really be uncompromising in a world where compromise is basically, you know, a modus operandi of getting employed. And you have to have a kind of an artistry that straddles the fence between artistry and putting asses in the seats in theaters, which is very, very difficult to do. It used to be, that was the way it was, all the way up until the 60s and 70s, and then it just started to turn around in the 80s. You know, I just blame...
Jaws?
I just blame, what's his name? George Lucas for the whole fucking thing.
Yeah. Those blockbusters where it has to be an event and you can't tell small movies.
You know, it was cool, you know, when Star Wars was like, you know, part of the zeitgeist. It's not cool when it's the only zeitgeist. It's not cool when it has completely overwhelmed the ability to see a beautiful little movie about people, which used to be all we went to see. Now we don't see them at all. And, you know, when they're made, which they're still being made, you know, like I made 7 myself in the last few years and no one has seen them because, you know.
Do you feel like TV's picked up some of the slack though, like Sons of Anarchy and, you know, you have these shows that in the past would have been the kind of characters and stories we would have told in some smaller movies?
I feel incredibly much like TV has picked up the slack. And I thank God for the state of TV right now, because there is some great writing and some great storytelling taking place on television. And that's due to the fact that there's so much competition that the only way to get the attention of the audience is to be even more original and edgy than the last guy. So people are like, you know, the great writers are like going into their deepest recesses of imagination and coming up with these phenomenal scenarios of worlds to depict. And TV is at this amazing, and it's also, people are getting paid. I mean, you can do the same thing in cinema right now, but you can't get paid. And everybody's gotta keep the lights on.
Yeah, it's a tough mix between art and commerce. It's kind of amazing anything good ever gets made when the balance is off. So let's turn to the audience. Let's take some questions. Where are
we? Let's have the audience turn on us.
Let's turn on us. Just tear us apart. Let's. Where are we? Up there. Yes.
I have a question. What was your favorite memory of desperation?
Talking about the not just general desperation.
You mean the Stephen King version?
Stephen King, right, yeah.
Not the desperation I feel in the morning when I wake up.
Yeah. It's the personal desperation.
I actually, that whole thing was such a kind of a gift, you know, to play this completely insane, almost vaudevillian, you know, like, he's like the Friars Club version of insanity. And probably the scenes that were the most fun to explore were the scenes with Tom Skerritt, where I pick him up by the side of the road and incarcerate him and plant marijuana, and, you know, I pull out every trick in the book on that guy. That was a couple of fun days of shooting. And he's a terrific, really a terrific guy to work with.
Where are we next? Middle, yes.
Hi, I just want to say first, I'm so happy to be here. I loved you in Hellboy. I loved you in Halo, but by far my favorite character that you play was Hannibal Chow in Pacific Rim. And one quirk about your character that I absolutely loved is, you know, you say how you came up with that name, and I wanted to ask, is Hannibal the real life one? Is he your favorite historical figure, and if not, who is? Thank you. Appreciate it.
Well, Hannibal is not my favorite historical figure, except in the fiction of Pacific Rim. My favorite historical figure, oh my God.
Is there one you'd like to play?
No. I'm about to play Hemingway, which thank you. As I research him, I find him, you know, he's like this onion you keep peeling off layers and you still haven't gotten anywhere close to the center. He's a very complex guy. I think my favorite historical figure might be Bob Dylan. And I mean, I don't really need to explain that to you, but he is, you talk about somebody who came around at the right time, and what he had to offer was something that pulled along an entire generation of dreamers. And then we all fucked it all up, you know. Just, our dreaming turned into, like, you know, portfolios on Wall Street, you know, and, like, you know, the other bullshit that when you get to be an adult.
How can we turn wonderful things into money? Where are we? Next question. We're up in the back there. Yes?
I just wanted to ask if you had any particularly funny or embarrassing moments from the set of Hellboy.
Hellboy, funny or embarrassing moments?
Well, there's always embarrassing moments in all of my films, my friend. And I'm sure there were many on Hellboy, but my medication doesn't allow me to recall them right now.
He's on Embarrassum. It removes those memories.
That's good, man. This guy's good. I may be doing commercials for Embarrassum. and the list of, you know...
Side effects?
You know, do not take if you notice your rash. You know, the list of qualifiers at the end of all these, you know, these drug commercials.
Gambling is one. When those side effects may include gambling.
Can you imagine the list of qualifiers at the end of Embarrassum? Ask your doctor.
And then you'll forget about asking your doctor because that's an embarrassing moment. Embarrassum would erase.
You can shit your pants.
Won't matter. Yes, you. Yes, right there.
So you play a lot of big guys and violent people.
Well, what the fuck am I going to play?
You have range. We could...
We really, really... I'd be really like a great actor if I could play a little guy, huh?
Yeah. You haven't seen him in Pippi Longstocking? He's great.
So my question was if you felt typecast, but I think that answers my question.
Yes, I'm such a victim. Me too.
Next
God
question.
Damn it. When will they love me for who I am? Rather than for this.
He's not a piece of meat, everybody.
I have feelings, you know. Harvey.
Yes, up here, yes.
Oh, hello. Well, we do love you. You've worked with... you've worked with Guillermo Del Toro, but you've also worked with other really innovative director, Jean-Pierre Jeunet, with City of Lost Children.
City of Lost Children, great.
And, like, that crazy, Aliens movie. What was that experience like working with that director?
That was intense, man. You know, working on City of Lost Children was, I was the only American. I was actually the only non-Frenchman who happened to be an American. I was the only one in the entire movie that needed an interpreter, because the only people who didn't speak English were the directors, and the only person who didn't speak French was me. But it was kind of like going to church. It was like a very reverential set, like these guys were making something sacred. And so there was a seriousness that kind of defined the whole six-month experience. You know, what they were reaching for was, you know, I hate to say this because it's probably going to sound, you know, like I'm a full of shit, you know, like, but, you know, like really, really classical cinema. They were reaching for something that was going to be a movie for the ages. I think they fell short, but I think they ended up making a very, very interesting film. And the circumstances around my being in it were as trippy as any that have ever occurred in my career. I mean, I really felt like, holy shit, like, how lucky can you be to be the one that's picked to be this fish out of water, you know, and this kind of innocent foreigner in a world that's locally decaying from within. Yeah, thank you very much. I really, really proud of the moments that went into making that film.
It's like a fairy tale, you know, it has that. Do you find yourself watching films and thinking, I'd really like to work with this director, or?
Yeah, I really would love to work with Paolo Sorrentino. You may know him from The Young Pope that he did with Jude Law. But he made a movie about 2 or 3 years ago called Youth, which I thought was exquisite. And before that, what is it? Something Beauty?
Oh, the
Great Beauty?
Yeah.
Phenomenal filmmaker. Istvan Szabo, I'd love to work with. Paul Thomas Anderson, I'd love to work with. You know, I would give anything to be on set with the Coen brothers.
So you have an affinity for these directors that have a very stylized, very auteur kind of, when they make a movie, we know it's one of their movies.
Yeah, well, you know, there's the thing about, that we love about cinema is that it does things that no other art form can do, because it's not any one thing. It's a conglomeration of all of the fine arts put together in one place. So you have narrative, which is great literature. And then you have production design, which is, you know, like painting, like which colors are gonna go into the pastiche that makes up this moving painting. And then you have lighting, which is this whole, I mean, then you have the clothes, and then you have, so you have like 45 different artists who do different things, who are the best in the world at what they do. And you, when you're working with guys like the ones I just mentioned, these guys are creating cinema at its most greatest potential, because it's purely unique, it's purely original, they never repeat themselves, they never do anything that they've seen somewhere else. And they're brilliant. They're dealing with worlds that are exquisite and important and uncomfortable, and, you know, all the while recognizable by all of us, because, you know, the human condition is our commonality, not our differences. So that's why I love movies, man.
Yeah. What's your favorite movie? Do you have a movie that you...
Godfather Part 1.
Yeah.
Godfather Part 1 is my favorite movie.
Yes.
Hi.
Hi.
I grew up watching you from the time I was probably like 2 or 3 to now. And,
in movies, not...
Yes.
Okay.
In movies. I'm not just secretly hanging out by your house. That'd be weird. But I wanted to ask, between the two Hellboy movies, what do you think was your favorite or most fun scene to shoot?
The drunken scene. You know, which is characterized by a little visit down Barry Manilow Lane. I mean, that is as absurd as it gets, you know. Two superheroes, you know, just drunk off their ass because they're both in love and they're sloppy and they're sentimental and they're on the verge of tears, and Barry Manilow comes to mind. That's Guillermo del Toro at his quintessential best. You know, I don't know anybody would have thought of that shit.
I think it was Jack Warden once said, like, the three things actors want to play most is drunk, their own twin, or their own death. I don't know how true that is, but one of those things.
Well, I'm not in that big of a hurry to play my own death, but...
Well, your character's death.
Oh, the character.
Not faking your death and moving to another country, which we may have to do. Next question? Yes.
When you were playing Sebulba in the Book of Life, what did you think about your character's personality?
Well, you know, he's a little devil. I mean, literally. I mean, he's from this other dimension, the land of the dead. He's very, very theatrical. He'll do anything to mess with people. You know, he's a provocateur, and there's something very, very compelling about watching a provocateur who has real power, because he's a god, and who has real intellect, and who is very creative in the way he messes with people. Now, I would say fucks with people, but you sound like you're a very small person.
Yeah, we wouldn't want to say that. Yeah.
So I don't want to, you know... I don't want to say, you know, like a word like that in front of, you know, a minor.
It would be horrible if she was to hear that word today. It would be... Yes.
So you talk a lot about...
I'm so sorry, man. I just can't help myself. I'm just so sorry.
Yes.
Yeah. So you're talking about the importance of getting people's asses in seats in the theaters, right? How do you feel about the medium of Netflix, Hulu, Amazon, and the importance of those mediums? Doesn't matter where the seat is, or, yeah.
Look, man, you know, they're here. For better or for worse, they're here. They've definitely transformed the way entertainment is delivered to people. And in so doing, they've transformed the way people want their entertainment delivered to them. People are no longer in a hurry to do that thing that we did for 100 years, which is, you know, take the wife, get in the car, go to a movie theater, buy some popcorn and a Coke, and sit in a dark place with 2,000 strangers and have this beautiful communal moment of watching magic on the screen. You know, that was not, I mean, you know, we did it great in America, but that's a worldwide thing, man, going to the movies and having a night where you're away from the kids and you're away from your problems and you're away from, you know, now it gets delivered to you, you know, and you're just like, at the point now where you can't tell the difference between watching it on here and watching it in 70 millimeter on a fucking screen. Nobody gives a shit anymore. That's what's happened when you desensitize an art form, when you normalize it, when you take the magic away from it by delivering it to everybody without ever having to get out of their fucking underwear and get off their couch. And, there is a difference between watching Lawrence of Arabia on this, yeah, And at the Ziegfeld in New York, you know, or the Cinerama Dome or whatever the great theater is here in Denver. I'm sure there's a great old theater here in Denver, you know, where you would go and want to watch Gone with the Wind or The Godfather Part One and just like, ha, ha, ha. But, you know, Netflix is here, man. Amazon is here. Hulu is here. They're here. And, you know, you can't fight it. It's just the way it goes. I don't even know what direction to turn up. I started a little independent movie company about 6 years ago. It's called Wing and a Prayer Pictures. We've now made about 8 or 9 movies, and I can't sell them. Some of them are pretty good. Some of them suck, but I mean, you know. I mean, you know, even Mickey Mantle only batted 330, you know. So I'm good, you know, that they're not all masterpieces, but they should sell. Somebody should want to buy even the shitty ones, you know. But they just, you know, we're past it. We're beyond it. We've opened a new Pandora's box, and I don't even know what to tell you, man. I don't know what to tell you. I don't know where it all goes. I know that there's a decay in the world right now. I know that this world that we're living in right now is not better than it was, you know, 50 years ago. Because of things like this, because the magic has been removed from a lot of stuff, and we've become desensitized to a lot of things that used to be beautiful and moving and magical and special. And now, you know.
In communal.
You could put something special on Twitter and they will ruin it in 30 seconds.
If that's a long time on Twitter. Do you remember the first movie you saw in the theater?
My dad had me going to the theater from the time I was 3 years old. I remember Shane. I remember the Ten Commandments. I don't know what years those movies. They were in the early 60s.
In the 50s.
Shane was like 53, and I saw that in the theater. The week it opened. I saw a lot of movies in the theater with my dad. My dad was a cinephile. He didn't know why. He just loved going to movies. He was just a working class stiff, blue collar guy. But he's the one who turned me on to loving movies.
Well, that to your point, like those are the people who need movies the most, like the people who need that escape in an environment that's not their everyday problem.
The problem is it is an escape, but it's also not an escape. What it is an affirmation.
Yeah.
That we all are in this shit together. I mean, that's what all. That's what the arts do. They just are little tiny truths happening all the time. Like, oh yeah, I know that, I felt that, I know what that guy's going through. You see it in paintings, you see it in music, you see it in dance, and it's just basically there to remind us that we're all in this shit together, which is why culture is so precious and so important and supersedes politics sometimes. Because politics is a trend. Mm-hmm. You know, you're up, you're down, you're on the left, you're on the right, you know. But the human condition, knowing that we're all in this together, that's a constant.
Yeah, one of my favorite quotes is, art is a lie that tells the truth. And it's so important to have, you know, that you need that in society.
This guy's good, man.
I try.
Hang on. Art is a lie that tells the truth.
I didn't make it up. It's someone else did, but I just remembered it. So we probably have time for two more. Where are we? Up over here, yes.
Hi. So what would you suggest for aspiring directors who want to make it into the film industry with the state it's currently in, with every blockbuster coming out like every 3 months, like trying to put something beautiful out like Guillermo del Toro does?
Well, the good news about the time we're living in is that you can take this thing and make your own movie. You know, you don't need any money, man. You can gather a few of your really, really cool creative friends and say, hey, I got an idea, you know, and, you know, just go do it. And people are really, that's how people are emerging right now, is basically they're going and doing shit and they're figuring out a way to have it get seen either on YouTube or, you know, some sort of an internet sharing thing. And boom, you know, if you resonate, if you click, if you get enough hits, people stand up and take notice, and suddenly you're in the mainstream. So that's how you do it.
There's no more gatekeepers, which is good and bad. So if you just do good work, and if it's going to find an audience, it will. If not, it's harder to bury movies now. Used to be a lot easier. Where are we? Yes.
First of all, thanks for doing what you do. You're one of my favorite actors. Over the course of your career, you've inspired me to feel every emotion I have, from laughter to tears and everything in the middle. So keep doing it for a long time. One of my favorites is The City of Lost Children. Obviously going to be challenging because the entire movie is delivered in French, and as you said, you're the only American on set. Can you tell me a little bit about the challenges of trying to deliver those lines in French? Did you have to learn them phonetically like Bela Lugosi, or did you actually have to learn some French?
You know, the interesting thing was, when I always knew I had to perform it in French, but the reason why they chose me is because they wanted somebody who didn't sound French. They wanted somebody who was living in this region, but who was a stranger. He was a stranger in a strange land. He was an innocent abroad. And so the decision we ultimately made that he was like Baltic. He was like Russian or Serbian. He had something, you know, like that kind of an approach to language. So I spoke French with a Russian accent in the movie. And you don't know that unless you're French. To you, it just sounds like, that's the worst French I've ever heard. But there was a reason for that. And the other thing is that when they actually gave me, you know, they gave me my lines to learn, because they knew it, I have to learn them to deliver them. All my lines were on one page. So the next time you go back to see the movie, if you ever see the movie, realize how little I speak in the film. And when I do speak, it's very, very short sentences and stuff. There was one speech that I gave that was a really long speech, and they ended up cutting it because it seemed like it wasn't my character, even though it was the most beautiful speech in the film. That's happened to me a lot, where the most beautiful thing in the film ends up getting cut because it doesn't seem to fit with the rest of it. But yeah, there wasn't that much to learn. It wasn't that hard.
Because they tailored the character for not
being
there.
Well, he was this guy who was basically mostly, the beauty of him was that he, instead of talking, he would listen, you know, and he was like, around all these kids, and he was feeling all of their pain and all of their frustration, and you know, he became everybody's big brother, not because he was talking, but because he was feeling and listening. That was the thing about the character that was kind of attractive.
So we have a minute left, and we have a quick question. Yes, where are we? Up there? Voice acting. Easy question to answer in a minute.
Well, you know I do a lot of it. So you know I love it. I'm a big fan of it. The reason why I love it is because I love acting in general, but voice acting requires not a lot of sitting around and analyzing and rehearsing. You basically walk in, and an hour later you've walked out and you've given a performance. So it's mostly being done on a very instinctive level. You know, like, you look at it, you say, I feel like this is the way it's going to be. Occasionally, a director will tweak what you're doing. But it's basically stand and deliver. And I really like working on a primal level like that. And, you know, just doing different voices. And some of those guys who work in animation in Los Angeles are the most talented mofos I've ever been around. So it's really, really cool to be in that setting. And yeah, it's very cool.
Are you ever surprised by the end result? Because it takes years sometimes to see what the animation looks like after you've voiced it. You ever see a movie and be like, oh, that's not what I was thinking?
Well, the good thing about me, because I'm 68 years old and I've had so many failures in my life, is that I expect everything to suck.
You're never disappointed.
So, you know, the only time I'm surprised is if it turns out good. And then it's a good surprise. It's like, oh, wow. I didn't see that coming, you know?
The beauty of pessimism. Yeah. Well, thank you guys, Rainer, and thank Ron Perlman for being here. Thank you, sir. Thank you guys so much.
There you go, David Harbour, Ron Perlman. Hope you guys enjoyed that. I certainly enjoyed talking to them. If you'd like to have me at your convention to do Q&As, you can email me at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com or kenatiicanread.com. Icanread.com, of course, being my stand-up comedy page, as I am, of course, also a stand-up comedian, and you can go see me live. There are live dates on there. You can purchase my album there, my albums. There's actually two. Or you can buy them on Amazon or iTunes or wherever fine digital music is sold. You can buy TV Guidance Counselor merchandise, including the, I think I have maybe 10 left of the Optimus Ken glow-in-the-dark TV Guidance Counselor enamel pins that I had at Denver Comic Con. That people were very excited about, wore very proudly. Once I sell out of them, Once I sell out of those enamel pins, I may do another round. So if people liked them, please let me know. I will take that into account and maybe make a new design. We have episodes every single Wednesday, so please subscribe to the show. It's always fun. We've been doing it for almost 5 years. Had over 360 guests, I think, on the show, which is pretty incredible. If I do say so myself, and as we head into the rest of the summer, into the fall, we have even more great guests coming up. So please be here next week, and we'll see you again then for a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor.
And he's not alone of men his age in 1985 thinking that a mustache is a good idea.
That's good, man. This guy is good.